Yeah, good. I'd like to call to order the meeting of the Twin Falls City Council for Monday, April 24th, and also confirm that we do have a quorum of the council here. All seven members are here this evening. The next item on the agenda is the Pledge of Allegiance. Those of you wishing to join us, please rise.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Mr. Rothweiler, do we have any amendments to the agenda this evening?
Mr. Mayor, members of the council, there are no amendments to the agenda this evening, and we would like to extend an apology. We do not have printed agendas this evening that we typically have. We are going through a new agenda software conversion, and tonight is the first time in which we're using that. So we would also ask that not only the council, but maybe those who are viewing the agenda through other means would continue to be, patient with us as we kind of work through this new process. Kathy Marcus is here to assist this in this new process. And so if the meeting appears to be a little maybe out of sorts, again, we apologize and we'll work through those issues together.
It's really going to test some of us old cats have been doing it the same way for generations.
Yes, she is. All of us.
The good news is there's a whole list and we can just follow along. So thank you, Travis. Next on the agenda are proclamations. We do have a proclamation this evening. It is our Arbor Day proclamation. Whereas in 1872, J. Sterling Morton proposed to the Nebraska Board of Agriculture that a special day be set aside for the planting of trees, and whereas this holiday called Arbor Day was first observed with the planting of more than a million trees in Nebraska, and whereas Arbor Day is now observed throughout the nation and the world, and whereas trees can reduce the erosion of our precious topsoil by wind and water, cut heating and cooling costs, moderate the temperature, clean the air, produce oxygen, and provide habitat for wildlife, and whereas trees are a renewable resource giving us paper, wood for our homes, fuel for our fires, and countless other wood products, and whereas trees in our city increase property values, enhance the economic vitality of business areas, and beautify our community, and whereas trees, wherever they are planted, are a source of joy and spiritual renewal, now therefore I, Sean Berriger, Mayor of the City of Twin Falls, do hereby proclaim Friday, April 28th, 2017, as Arbor Day in the City of Twin Falls, and I urge all citizens to celebrate Arbor Day and to support efforts to protect our trees and woodlands, and further, I urge all citizens to plant trees to gladden the heart and promote the well-being of this and future generations. And we have Wendy Davis, our Parks and Recreation Director, here to accept the proclamation, which I do not have a copy of. So we're good there, right? So I got lost. I was like, where is it? But it's here in my packet. So.
And actually, it's my pleasure. We have with us this evening Gary Bates. He's the Southern Idaho Community Forester, and he made a special trip to present us with our flag and our award tonight. So I'm going to give it over to him for a minute, and I think he's got a flag to present. So.
Great. Thank you.
Mayor, City Council members, thanks for the time tonight. I do urban forestry for the Idaho Department of Lands in all of southern Idaho. The area that I cover is from McCall to Montpelier. It's my job to help cities develop sustainable urban forestry programs. One of the programs that we administer in the state is the Tree City USA program. Tree City USA started in 1976 as a way to commemorate our nation's bicentennial through the lasting contribution that trees make to the citizens and the community. There are a lot of benefits that trees offer beyond shade and beauty. I'm not here tonight to really talk about all of those, but there are four things that the city has to do to be a Tree City USA. The first is that they have a tree committee or a tree department that advises the mayor and the city council for the care of the publicly owned trees. The next thing that you have to do is have a tree ordinance that administers for the care of those publicly owned trees. I believe you folks revised yours 3 or 4 years ago or something like that. It's actually one of the better ordinances in the state. The third thing that you have to do is spend a minimum of $2 per capita for the care of those publicly owned trees. That $2 does not have to be hard cash out of the city council budget. It can be donated goods and services, volunteer time, line clearance for utility easements. I mean, it can be a lot of different things. $2 is the minimum standard. Twin Falls identified last year $2.58 per capita for the care of the publicly owned trees. And finally, the best thing, you have to celebrate Arbor Day. I'm not able to be here on Arbor Day. It actually worked out really well for me to be able to present the award to the City Council tonight. I'll be in Boise at the State of Idaho celebration. Arbor Day is always the last, well, the National Arbor Day is the last Friday of April, and that's April 28th this year. It's my birthday, too. But anyway, so on behalf of the Idaho Department of Lands, who I work for, and the Arbor Day Foundation, it's my pleasure to present the 19th annual Tree City USA Award to the City of Twin Falls, and we encourage you to continue to plan, care for, and plant trees in your community. We have a flag that we give you annually, and then... Oh, you did. So, anyway...
So why don't we go stand up
there?
Yeah,
that's
good.
You
want to stand up for
a second while? Picture. Beautiful. Very nice.
How does that work?
Very nice.
Yeah,
man. We can cozy up. That was good. Cozy up. There we go. Yeah, I didn't go with the bag.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Well, I like it when there's only one shot.
And Wendy, did you have any other details about Friday's event that you wanted to share?
Yes, so Friday at 4 o'clock at Clyde Thompson Park, we will be planting 4 trees. We planted some trees for Arbor Day at Clyde Thompson Park in 2007, so we're visiting that again 10 years later. And anybody that would like to join us is welcome to come. We'll read the proclamation and we'll plant some trees, and it'll probably be windy and snowy and rainy and sunny and all kinds of things.
A little bit of everything.
Please join us.
What time is that again?
4 p.m.
Thank you.
Greg Lanting?
Wendy? I went by the big tank out on Highway 74, Washington 74, the other day, and there's a lot of trees planted out there. Is that our nursery, tree nursery? Okay, all right.
Tree farm. Yes, that's our tree farm.
Yeah, okay, thank you.
All right, thank you. Next on the agenda is an opportunity for general public input, and I believe we had some folks sign in. Sir. So again, this is an opportunity for members of the public to comment on items that are not on this evening's agenda. And I would just remind folks of our procedures that to provide public input regarding matters relevant to the City of Twin Falls, you'll be recognized by the mayor. You'll approach the microphone and podium. Please state your name and address and whether you are a resident or property owner in the City of Twin Falls, and then proceed with your input. We are going to limit that to 3 minutes per individual this evening. Councilman Reed will have a timer up there for you to keep on time, and we appreciate that. So the first one, is it Dale? I'm sorry, I can't. Yeah, just go ahead and stand up there at the podium. What did you say your last name was, sir?
Snow.
Snow. Thank you.
Okay.
Welcome.
Thank you.
So, again, if you state your name and address for the record.
I don't want to do my address, but I do own a couple properties in town.
Okay.
But you're saying this going on the Internet, right?
Yes.
Okay, so I ain't going to give my address. I'll give my name. I lived in Idaho for 55 years, on and off. Your roads are messed up. How come we ain't fixing or putting dirt in them? You tore the front end off my Jag. I mean, if I would have been on a motorcycle, I would have died. You got holes that are... 2-3 feet wide, 4 feet deep. Nobody's even putting gravel in. This is almost May 5th. Nobody has a problem with that, right? It's cool. Let's do business as usual. Okay. I just found out about that poor little 5-year-old girl. And I've been told, maybe it's not true, but all you got, the members, council, whatever, I can't, mayor, that you told her that you didn't know nothing about this case, right? Right or wrong, yes or no?
No.
You didn't know nothing about that case.
So when it was first brought to our attention, we were not aware of it, and then
okay.
we...
Okay, that's it. Let me get. I've got 3 minutes.
Okay.
I don't see how anybody can be on the city council and not know that went on, but that's your business. I got a friend that owns a shop on Main. A couple weeks, you already heard this deal. Somebody spits in your face, tells you they're going to kill you. It's not if, when, Allah Akbar. That's terrorism or jihadi, period. Don't have nothing to do with religion. Just people live like people, people like people. You guys say you know nothing about it. I got it. So how can a 14-year-old kid and an 8 and a 9 get 30 days home arrest and nothing? How come they ain't saying anything until they're 21 or until they die? Especially the 14-year-old, right? You see anything that's not right here with that? Just as human beings? Human beings. Race is not an issue here. Nobody has a problem with that? You think, how does a kid that goes to school, say 14 or 9, 8, and you can rape and molest and mutilate a 5-year-old and get 30 days home arrest and nothing on your record? Everybody okay with that? Think it's nice and fine? Nobody in Twin knows where these families lived. So now you got a 14-year-old rapist that get 30 days home arrest that's out in the city, right? You agree with that or no? Nobody's going to say yes or no? Okay, I'll wait for my time to be up. You say nothing, says everything to everybody. Whew. I'm probably going to run out of time for what I got to say, but does anybody in this state or world and the United States realize what any immigrant gets that comes over here as a refugee that CSI brings in that I got to pay, you got to pay? Everybody in the whole goddamn county and state got it.
So,
you know, they get $58,000 cash when they get here. They get $5,000 a year.
Mr. Snow, your time is up.
Oh, what's up? Thanks. Well, I guess when the national news media just cut me off 3 minutes, then I think, what kind of oath did you take when you become a city councilor mayor? Was it the constitutional or a state oath?
Yeah. So, again, thank you for your input.
But you at least got to answer that. Okay. That's
yeah,
all I'm going to ask.
We take an oath to uphold the laws.
Is it a constitutional or is it a state oath?
Happy to answer your question if you give me the opportunity.
Well, I know you're going to ramble on. Just it's a yes or no.
So the oath is to uphold the laws of the United States.
The Constitution. State of,
excuse
not
me.
The United States.
Yes,
the Constitution.
Yes, the constitutional
right.
laws. The,
not an Idaho pass statute.
Geez, sir, can I answer
so
your question? Okay, Mr. Snow.
All of you.
Mr. Snow, your time is up.
I know, but y'all committed perjury. Y'all going to get fired.
Will you please, take your seat?
November, okay?
Please take your seat so we can move on
I'm
with the agenda.
Here.
All right,
that's
thank you.
That's why nothing gets done. A woman gets 2 felonies, calls the police, tries to get the police to help her, and they
Mr.
say they
Snow.
Can't help her.
Mr. Snow, your time
then
is up.
Then she comes down here. I don't care. You can arrest me, whatever. I don't care. But this shit's gone on long enough. You guys come down, a poor lady that said, spit in her face, that she's going to die, going to kill her, not when, if. You guys, I don't know about no 5-year-old getting raped. Well, how could you live in any country, not any state, much less across the world, and not know about this?
Your time's up.
I know.
Sir,
but
please.
That's the problem with you people.
Okay, your time's
you
up.
You lied. That lady come down here to get help for you. 2 felonies committed to her. And you guys, we can't do nothing. We can't help you. Cops won't help her. When I grew up, you committed a misdemeanor battery, you went to jail. You commit 2 felonies, you get arrested.
Mr. Snow.
You guys just think, hell,
Mr. Snow.
Everything fine.
Thank you.
We'll talk to you later. You guys all need to find a new job. Everybody got a fire. You can hire somebody that got some brain. Run this city. Yeah, you will record it, or I'll sue you if
right.
you didn't record it. It didn't go out on the
Next internet. To speak is Mr. Terry Edwards. Mr. Edwards.
No thanks.
Okay.
enough of you guys.
Dave, you're here for the public hearing. John Capillaris.
John Capillaris, 1231 Sunburst. Mayor and Council, I rise to speak in favor of a welcome city resolution. The two sides of the issue before the council fall to either morality of welcoming the stranger or keeping the stranger out in the name of security. I shall argue for morality, and that security is a moot point in this circumstance. Western civilization is replete with teachings to be welcoming to strangers. Though there are many examples to the contrary, such as Spain in the 1490s to Germany in the 1930s and 40s, or closer to home with the Chinese Exclusion Act, or after World War I when we excluded almost everybody. But one may argue that these examples are easy to point out, not because they are traditions, but which they're not, they are aberrations. From our Christian Judeo tradition, we have teachings such as Leviticus 19:33, and if a stranger sojourn with you in your land, ye shall not vex him, all the way to the Good Samaritan. From our Greco-Roman tradition, we can learn in the Iliad and the Odyssey that we owe strangers hospitality, otherwise we earn the wrath of the gods. Euripides wrote 2,500 years ago, putting the theme of justice into the voices of the Athenian chorus, who in his play were defending the stateless Heraclide in the Children of Heracles. "'Twere impious for the state to neglect the suppliant stranger's prayers. This land is ever ready in an honest cause to aid the helpless." The opposition's argument is based on security, but this is a moot point. It is not the place of this august body to discuss vetting procedures of the Department of State. The entire array of tools for vetting are the purview of the military, diplomatic corps, and the intelligence community, and are carefully guarded secrets. I can say, as someone who has been involved on the periphery of American power, that our federal government does a fine job in keeping us safe. To say more would compromise national security. The moral high ground is our best defense. For the sake of the common good, we must direct our scrutiny elsewhere. Stop harassing strangers and welcome them. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Capillaris. I also have Susie Capillaris.
Reside at the same address, 1231 Sunburst. I'm here to offer some public input on the welcoming city resolution. I wanted to share that one of the things, I was born and raised in Twin Falls. I left and I said I'd never come back. You know me, you've heard that before. One of the things that drew me back to Twin Falls was the fact that the diversity has increased, that there are many different cultures. I don't care. I've said it before. We live in an era when a statement of welcome is necessary, unfortunately, because if you don't say that you're welcome, people are going to assume that you're unwelcoming because there are some very loud voices, some of which we just heard, who will speak loudly enough that people think that's what everybody thinks. As a teacher and as a parent and as an individual, I believe strongly in teaching my children and teaching those around me, teaching the college students, teaching everybody, that knowledge and information enriches our lives and it drives out fear. I believe that we should welcome the positive that refugees and immigrants of all varieties and stripes bring to our community. The different foods, the different ideas, the different experiences and cultures that they bring, that they are not a detriment, but that they are a benefit to our community as a whole. I am proud to raise my children here where they can meet people from all over and share the American experience with them, because white, Christian, heterosexual, whatever, that is not the extent of the American experience. The American experience can encompass and should encompass so much more than that. And I would be so proud if our city made a resolution declaring that we are a welcoming city, because it's what I have seen in our community and it's who I believe we are as people. And that's all I have to say. thank you for your time.
Thank you. Next, I have Bethany Rasmussen. Welcome.
Hi, I'm Bethany Rasmussen, and I am a resident of Twin Falls. It was actually kind of interesting that that man came up and was talking about the roads in Twin Falls. I was so encouraged to drive down Falls on Saturday and actually be able to get through there without worrying about the front of my car getting bumped up. And so I just wanted to commend the city for doing that. I was so encouraged it was done in 2 days, and that just was really amazing. And so I'm excited to see what else will be done with the other roads and our new city hall. So thank you.
Thank you. So that's all I had signed up. Is there anyone else who wishes to address the council as part of the public input? Please come forward.
Hi, my name is Glenita Zeiderveld. I'm actually a Jerome resident all my life. And I wasn't going to speak, but I feel led to speak, being very close to this case. Let's just say I've been a fly on the wall. And I have witnessed many things that are very, very grieving to me. And as we are doing this welcoming city, what do you intend? And I actually would like it in writing on what you do plan on doing to welcome them. Because, you know, there is a culture difference. There is. And so when we bring them in, we just can't say, oh, here you are. Good luck. You're in America. Obviously, with what's going on with the little girl and the boys, is a cultural difference. They come to America, they broke our laws, and now we are witnessing this. So going forward and trying to learn from this, what do you plan on doing? Because if you're going to make it a welcoming city, then I think we deserve to know as citizens on what you're going to do. So not only are you going to welcome them, but to make sure that we're safe. And let's give an example of foster family. Okay, you're going to bring in some foster kids. Okay, that's going to be a huge change in the family dynamics. Okay, the family that you're bringing in is from a war-torn family situation, just to give an example. Okay, so this family's coming in, these children are coming in with a lot of baggage, a lot of hurt, a lot of resentment, and knowing only what they know from their family. So now they're coming into a new family. Okay, the parents want to help them and make them feel welcome, okay? So they do all these things to make them feel welcome, but what happens is the rules for their kids and the rules for the foster kids are a little different because they feel bad. So let's say their curfew. This child, your child, has to be home at 12 no matter what because they're your child. This child gets off because you feel bad for them. How long will it be before your community is so torn apart because of the separate rules? So when you bring in the refugees, or what are we doing to teach them our laws, to let them know that we stand by our laws? They're not only meant for the children, the citizens of Twin, but they're also meant for the foster children coming in. This problem isn't going to go away for you guys. You know, I am witnessing this, and there is a culture, and there is a lot of good people helping both sides. But what are our motives? You know, I see a lot of things going on also with these boys. Can I go just a little bit further?
You can't. Your time is up. I'm sorry. So you can finish your thought, and then you can wrap it up.
So, can you help me where I left off?
So basically you've asked that whatever this resolution
becomes, what are you going to do as a city? Can we get that in detailed writing? Yeah. Your plan, as you're going to do this welcome city, can we get a detailed plan of what you're going to do to make sure that they're vetted, that they're going to follow our rules, that they're going to assimilate to the way we do things? What is your plan, and can we have that in written detail of what your plan is for that? Because you can't just welcome them without having a plan for everything.
Thank you for your input. Again, anyone else who wishes to address the council?
thank you all for your input. Next on the agenda is the consent calendar. Council wishes. Chris Dawkins.
Move approval as printed.
Second.
I'm trying to get to the right spot here. A motion by Chris Dawkins and seconded by Nikki Boyd to approve the consent calendar. Is there any discussion? Seeing none, Sharon, roll call vote, please.
John Berger.
Yes.
Nikki Boyd.
Yes.
Suzanne Hawkins.
Yes.
Greg Lanting.
Yes.
Ruth Pierce.
Yes.
Christopher Reed.
Yes.
Chris Talkington.
Yes.
That was a weird one. Motion passes 7-0.
That was alphabetical order. Alphabetical. Confused us.
Yeah. We're all looking around. All
right. So, if anyone is here for the special event application, that was just approved on the consent calendar. So, I just want to give you the heads up there. Next, under items for consideration, the
first is a presentation of the Distinguished Budget Award received by the City of Twin Falls for the 2016 fiscal year budget for the year ended September 30, 2016. We have our City Manager, Travis Rothweiler.
So, Mr. Mayor, members of the Council, before I begin, I'm hoping that Lori Race, Brent Height, and Shane Carpenter can kind of come forward. So I want to take you back a few years that when we were starting our budgeting processes, we developed a lot of things that really followed more of a line item approach, and you would get lots of line items and you would get lots of justification, but our budgets didn't necessarily tell a story. It didn't incorporate a long-term perspective of how we hope those expenditures are going to help realize a second important piece, which is a connection to a strategic plan. And it didn't describe the outcomes that we hoped to realize from those expenditures. In fact, you would see a dollar sign that was in a spreadsheet, and you wouldn't be able to make a connection in terms of the output and the outcomes. We didn't really describe and communicate what the citizens, our shareholders of our corporation, could expect from the results of those efforts. And it certainly was not necessarily built in the processes moving forward. So this team started a journey about 5 years ago. And this is the fourth consecutive year in which they have received the GFOA award. So there are tens of thousands of different local government entities all across the country, and not just cities, but counties, school districts, state governments. And the city of Twin Falls is one of three cities in the state at last count to receive the GFOA award, and we're even part of a smaller group of individuals who not only receive this award, but I want to jinx it, Brent, but who also hopefully receive the Comprehensive Annual Financial Report, or CAFR, as a result of the effort of the fiscal year process as well. This matters because it provides an insight and accounting to what we do and how we spend the people's money. It talks about the goals and the objectives that we have with every single budget moving forward. And it is our part to be incredibly transparent, and tonight you will have another update as to where we're at, where these budgets that we're putting together aren't just a collection of spreadsheets, but they're numbers, they're words, and they're pictures, recognizing that the individuals who consume information need to have it in many different layers. So, Mr. Mayor, members of the Council, it is my pleasure to present to Lori and her team the Distinguished Budget Award for the fourth consecutive year to the City of Twin Falls for the fiscal year that began on October 1st of 2016.
Now, these are the guys that get the attention here.
Sure.
Do you want us to stand?
Yeah.
Excellent.
I'm
going
to slip
my
skin here from
I'm much younger, Greg.
Way to go. Well, thank you to you all for your hard work and dedication, and I'm sure that all of your energies will be rolled in nicely to the PowerPoint presentation that we'll get here in just a little bit. Ruth Pierce.
I'm always happy that geeks win awards on accounting, right? So, congrats. Great team.
Ruth, you might appreciate as a CPA, but I hear that our finance team is so good that they don't even order pencils with erasers anymore. Something you've been doing for years.
And next on the agenda is a request to appoint three new Traffic Safety Commission members. I'm going to guess that's me. Or Ryan. It's Ryan Howe. Ryan can do it. Welcome, sir.
Good evening, Mayor. You actually get to appoint them.
Yes.
And then allow the council to confirm them. The three members that we have that have been selected and gone through a background check are Brenda Hughes, who will be representing the Twin Falls Chamber of Commerce position on the Traffic Safety Commission. John Capillaris, who is a member at large, and then Ken Wiesmore Sr. is also a member at large. We're also requesting that there is a reappointment of Brady Dickinson as the representative from the Twin Falls School District for a second three-year term.
Thank you. So I would note that Nikki and I participated in interviews of these folks, and definitely some interest and energy from them, and we look forward to the opportunity for them to serve on the Traffic Safety Commission. So I would recommend that these folks be appointed as stated, and would entertain a motion. Nikki Boyd.
I move that we appoint all three plus Brady for another term.
Second.
A motion by Nikki Boyd, seconded by Ruth Pierce, to approve the appointment of the three new Traffic Safety Commission members and the reappointment of Brady Dickinson. Is there any discussion? Sharon, roll call vote, please.
Nikki Boyd?
Yes.
Suzanne Hawkins?
Yes.
Greg Lanting?
Yes.
Ruth Pierce?
Yes.
Christopher Reed?
Yes.
Chris Talkington?
Yes.
Sean Berriger?
Yes. Motion passes 7-0. Thank you, and I know John is here, so thank you, John. John may be the only one of them is here, as I'm searching out there. Next is a request to approve Twin Falls Recreation Center Ad Hoc Committee. Our Parks and Recreation Director, Wendy Davis.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. This evening, I would like to kind of outline the approach that we're thinking about taking with this committee and see if you have any guidance or suggestions, or if you just want to appoint it and move forward. The formation of this committee would be our first step in beginning the process of making this recreation center a reality. Obviously, we have gathered information in the past that through the Parks and Recreation Master Plan, through the Citizen Survey, through the strategic plan that identifies that there's a need for a recreation center in the community. And so we feel like the actual needs assessment has already kind of been done, and we have direction from council to move forward on this. And so the intention at this point really is to set this group up for success. We've tried this before. I'd like this time for us to come forward with a recommendation, a proposal that is something we can move on. And so we're hoping that we've got a plan here that will provide us with what we need in order to start to take action on moving forward with the Recreation Center. So hoping that it's a plan that's feasible, meets the needs of the community, and is self-supporting and sustainable. And so I see that kind of as a two-part endeavor. One is clearly identified expectations of this committee to make sure we're clear on what they need to do and what they need to bring back. And second of all is a commitment to them and to the process, both in supporting what's coming forward and potentially some resources and funds to make it happen. when we talk about a recreation center, that obviously means different things to different people. And we were talking about this today and laughing, sort of, that, you know, in the citizen survey, it asks for people's satisfaction with recreation centers and facilities. Well, the satisfaction has dropped 10% in the last 2 years of people's satisfaction with recreation centers. But my question is, what do they think the recreation center is? So they obviously are dissatisfied with whatever they think it is, but when you can't really even define it for that kind of a thing, and then when we talk about a recreation center just in general, I think if I ask each one of you what you think a recreation center should be, it's probably going to be a little bit different. So it becomes apparent that while we've got a need and interest and perceived already, we probably need to put together a feasibility study that would guide the development of a plan. And through a feasibility study, we can get a market analysis. We can get an architectural program, design components, a conceptual layout, projected capital costs, operation analysis, partner analysis, and then at the end we have a product that we can move forward with. And so right now the intention would be that we form this ad hoc committee, we task them with coming up with, maybe not actually writing the RFQ, but reviewing RFQs and selecting a company to do a feasibility study. But obviously in order to do that, that's going to cost a little bit more money than the $10,000 that I have. And so right now, I don't think that we're looking at asking for money at the moment, but just maybe support of the concept and the process, and that by forming this committee, we're committed to the process and the dedication of resources in order for them to come forward with a solid plan and recommendations that we can make this a reality. So I don't know if you want to kind of walk through the charter as I presented it, or if anybody had any questions if they took a look at it. But basically, we're establishing that the need exists, that our facilities are inadequate at this point, especially the city-owned facilities, because we don't have many indoor type of things. The Parks and Rec Master Plan specifically talks about the need for some indoor recreation opportunities. The strategic plan talks about a healthy community and tasks me or whoever with finding sources for funding and making this happen. So down to the objectives, I have preparing an RFQ, reviewing concept options, establishing the amenity priorities to be included, which is all part of what would happen with a feasibility study as well. So that would kind of help guide that process. And that kind of came about after I wrote this. But as we did a little bit more research into what a feasibility study would cost and how we could do this, I'm kind of integrating the two together, but we already kind of had that on the list. And then what we'd really like to be able to do is come forward with a plan, identify funding sources, and then have this group help us actively recruit and secure funding to make it happen. I think I've identified 12 community members representing different factions and two liaisons, which would be one council liaison and one Parks and Rec Commission liaison. And then we would hire a facilitator to lead the process. And they'd have the power to deliberate, make recommendations, and try to come to consensus with a plan of some sort. And I set the goal of 4 years, but Mitch said we could do it in two, so. Does anybody have any questions or any thoughts or any guidance on this?
Yeah, so Chris Tompkins.
Well, I would agree that we're probably approaching the time where a community recreation center makes sense, especially because we're a growing community and we don't have adequate facilities like you mentioned with the swimming pool and the church and a few of the others. I also think that you've done a fairly good job of outlining the objectives at 7 or 8 points, but frankly, the feedback I've gotten from several people that live in the community is that they don't believe it should be funded entirely with tax money. That we need to have the commitment of the community shown through not only some grants that hopefully Mandy can help us get, but private donations. And so your last dot line, actively participate in securing funding for building a rec center, I think needs to be more specific, with the goal of X percent from private or non-taxpayer funding sources. I think that if there is a demonstration of people willing to put money in, I don't know if it's something such as we're doing downtown where you get your name on a brick or on a wall, that there's the ability for us to expand the base of popularity for such a recreation center, especially if it comes out of people's pocketbooks rather than out of entirely on its basis of property taxes. So that would be my only constructive criticism to it, is to set a goal of X percent non-property tax funding.
Chris Reed.
Wendy, so as I was looking over this, I've been on two committees like this, the wastewater and then also the City Hall, the new City Hall committee. Outcomes, you know, the committees were a little different. Looking at the committee membership, though, one thing that worked really well for the wastewater is we have just allowed everybody who attended to be a voting member. I know that the City Hall didn't function that well when everybody had a say. It got a little cumbersome. I'm concerned, though, with just targeting these industries or these areas. That
we might be missing some.
Somebody's not going to be able to have a voice at the table. And especially when my biggest concern kind of goes back to what Chris was talking about, the financing part. It's expensive, and it's not expensive just a one-time payment. It's an ongoing expense. So just to make sure that everybody has a voice there and nobody feels like in the end, well, I sat in the meetings, but I didn't get a say.
And I think I pulled one out and I turned it into at-large, but it's kind of in the middle of the list.
Yeah.
But at this point, I wound up with one at-large. So you're thinking adding?
I don't know. I mean, I don't want to say there's a whole bunch, but allowing people that are there to have a say.
Travis.
You know, I think that Councilman Reed brings up a really good point in terms of the diversity of the two committees, and I might take a minute to share why we've drifted more of through an assignment of a place and responsibility. Recognizing that this is very, very similar to the process that we used when we were looking at other processes of late that were ad hoc committees and coming forward. What we're asking these members to do, and if you add additional at-large members, that would be very appropriate. If you want to do something different than this list, that would be equally appropriate, because it's important to recognize this is a group of individuals that would come and present and make a recommendation to you and then have a responsibility, like in the wastewater, to help share that recommendation in moving forward. One of the things you'll recall in the City Hall conversation is that because it was a come one and come all, there wasn't a sense of ownership and that you always had to show up at all of those meetings to be
completely
there, be a participant. And so what we've said is that by being an actual member of the committee and having that assignment and that designation would cause more ownership, which may cause greater dedication to the process. The other avenue is that every single one of those meetings is open to the public for their review, their participation, their conversation. And it's not that they can't participate, but we are expecting this list of folks to be the ones that stand behind the recommendation that are ultimately being presented to the City Council. Again, with input from lots of different sources, but just trying to make sure that we have that buy-in on that front end moving forward.
So I would just add briefly to that. So recently with the Canyon Springs Grade Committee, that
Correct.
Committee had designated positions by proximity or function, yet each of those meetings had an opportunity for public input, and there were a lot of members of the public from you know, maybe even some uses that people weren't aware of were going on down there that had that chance to give that input.
Good.
You know, perhaps adding another at-large member so we'd have a couple might make sense. Again, I think you want to be careful that this doesn't become a 20-person committee, because we had a lot of that in the last rec center committee that reviewed it.
And that makes sense.
Greg Lanting.
Well, Wendy, thank you for bringing this forth and doing the work on it. And I suppose these are all things you're going to be making a determination in the committee of whether it's out. It's a rec district. I believe Jerome has a rec district. Filer has a rec district. But those are all decisions you'll be making. I was mayor when we last ventured deeply into this, and Sean talked about there was such a wide divergency of what they wanted in the rec center. I mean, there was people who wanted very specific things here, and then you had others that had this indoor soccer fields, and you know, it was just there was such a wide range of thoughts about what we needed, what Twin Falls needed, and where it needed to be, and those types of things. That I also worry that if you get the committee too large, that it will be we'll have that same problem. We need a group that is responsible for the activity. They know what they're pointing towards, and they come forth with an idea. But certainly allowing, if other people show up, just like people show up with our public comment, I would assume that this committee should have opportunities. If somebody shows up with an idea, they should get a chance to at least have that idea heard. It may not be an idea that works, but at least have that idea heard. And so that's what I would suggest. Thank you, though.
So this evening you are seeking approval to form the committee and adopt the charter, and then depending upon...
I may be back.
Yeah. And then you, at some future point, you would bring us names to fit these slots?
Yes, I think that's what we were thinking, right? We would bring forth a slate.
Travis?
Yeah, so I really want to emphasize that... So when we were going through the process, and I think this is a critical piece that I don't want it to be overlooked, and maybe you guys, as members of the council, understood that Mitch and I were having a conversation, and we want to just make sure, again, to emphasize this point. The council at the beginning of the process allocated $10,000 to help oversee this process, and as Wendy had shared, and as we had the conversations, we believe that would bring you back to the same place that we are right now, and that is we want to have a rec center. And as Phil has been going out and having a conversation with community stakeholders and different groups, the single largest thing that he has shared in his notes with me is the need and the desire to have a community recreation center. Now, as Wendy has shared, and I think as Councilman Lanting shared, how that is defined is really, really across the board. And if we had time this evening, Wendy wanted to take 5 minutes, have you all take just list the top five things that you think are in a rec center. And we were fairly confident that there would be some commonality, but there also might be some significant divergence of opinion. What we want to do with this committee is bring that together through a feasibility plan, because it not only defines what we're trying to create, but then it also defines the best avenues to get there. And then it branches into numerous places. One might be this process is the creation of a recreation district. And that might be larger than just the geographic boundary of the city of Twin Falls. And then there's a series of steps outlined in Idaho Code on how you get there. Or this might be something that through this process can be wholly contained within the city's boundaries. And then there's two costs. There's the cost of how do you construct it and the steps that you take to construct it. And then there's a second cost, and that cost is to the operations, the maintenance, and the upkeep. And how do you make sure that after you construct it, it is sustainable and viable into the future? The feasibility study that we believe that Wendy's asking for will answer all of those questions, and it kind of enumerates those different things. It does cost more than $10,000. In fact, we expect it to cost considerably more than $10,000. And so there's two steps in this process. The first step in that process is to go forward and recognize that we would like to have a committee to help define what is a rec center and to go through that process. But the second is to go through an RFQ that we can help find that person that has those expertise to move through this process. And we're really taking a page out of what we did on the Canyon Springs stabilization project. You remember there was a facilitator, but then we also dedicated significant funding to an engineer to be able to assist with, well, these are those probable costs and these are some of those probable solutions. That's that piece in that that we're looking for here. And there's two ways to fund it. We've had conversations with Lori today. We believe that we have, well, we know that we have money in not only contingency that we budget in our capital fund every year, we also have cash reserves, but we also could make a commitment to fund it in the upcoming year budget as well. And so we wanted to have those conversations because that's an integral part of this conversation tonight. It's not just approving the charter because we think that the charter will get you to the same response that we already know.
And I think I just want to add on to that just a tiny bit more to say that that was partly, I think that the commitment to this committee, if we're going to do this, I think we need to be ready to take that next step. And if we're concerned about taking that next step with the feasibility study, then maybe we don't do this right now. But that's kind of where we were coming from, is in order to really do this right, we're going to have to dedicate some funds probably to make this happen. And so part of agreeing to move forward with this charter is probably going to include that next piece, that when we come back with the request for feasibility study, that we're prepared to swallow that.
Chris Tarkenton.
Well, I'm a little surprised that we're thinking that council has the wisdom to be able to come up with a coherent statement on a recreation center's purpose. I really think that a shortcut would be to check what other recreation centers around the state and the area have as their mission statement. Why should we want to invent the wheel again? There has to be a lot of commonality in what either a recreation district or a community's recreation center offers or decides not to offer or is found through practical purpose does not work.
And that's what I think the feasibility study should bring us, that kind of information, the kinds of amenities that can generate revenue, funding mechanisms and opportunities, what different ways to go at that. And so that would be the intention. The only reason the exercise would have been is to just demonstrate the fact that there's a lot of different ideas out there and it means something different to everybody else.
The other thing I was going to bring up is that in public administration, there's a lot of study done on the effectiveness of groups, and really 7 to 9 is your upper limit. 7's about optimal. When we're talking about 11 here and we're going to add 1 or 2 more, you'll end up with 20% doing 80% of the talking and decision making. So I see some duplications in who you've included there. I'm not going to get in there, just my ideas, but I think a smaller group's going to be more effective.
Suzanne Hawkins.
So when you first said 4 years and then Mitch said 2 years, I have to tell you both of those scare me. that seems like a long amount of time to just get in there and get the study done and hit the ground running. Just my input.
I'd love for it to be quicker.
Go ahead.
So I think that what they're trying to do is manage expectations.
I have high expectations.
So do I. I really believe that the faster that we can go through with this, identify the individuals, bring them back to the city council, have them begin to work on their collaborative vision of what would be successful in Twin Falls, what fills those needs. While I agree that there are some basic fundamental services that are similar, I think that Twin Falls has some unique circumstances that may not be available in all areas as well. So while there might be some good ideas that we can draft from other places, I don't think that there's one thing that we can just snatch and replicate. Going through that process and then having them get to know our community, I think that what I'm hoping is that whatever that solution is before you within a year, and that we are within that 1 year time frame taking the necessary steps to see what is being recommended, what is being proposed, and then taking those steps to realize that vision and asking this committee to help realize that vision as well, very similar to what we did on all of those other processes. I think that if you create a much more or much longer process, I think that you run into two problems. I think number one, as you probably see, when you run for city council, a four-year commitment can be long, and so asking and saying this is going to be a four-year process could be maybe scare off some individuals. But I also think that those individuals who are very passionate about us doing something might say, why is it going to take you 4 years to study this project? And so I really believe that this is something that we could have a recommendation back to you within one calendar year.
Chris Reed?
You had mentioned the feasibility study being a little bit more expensive, and I'm not asking for exact dollar amount. When you say that, what dollar amount are we talking?
We have an estimate of 69.
What's that?
59 with some add-ons if we wanted, 59,000.
Okay.
And that was just to give us a ballpark to know what we're talking about.
But I would only add that, if the direction is to move forward with designing and figuring out a way to build a recreation center, I think we need to invest the funds on the front end to make sure we're building what it is we need to be building as a significant investment for the community. Mm-hmm. This is we're back in the 50-100 year range of what we're building for. So I do think that we need to try to have a good solid feasibility of what's going to work and what isn't, so that we don't create an albatross that we then have to fund for the next forever. So I think this direction is good. I don't think we need to have another committee like we had last time, which is get everybody together, come up with your ideas, and then say, sure wish we had a recreation center that had all these things in it, which was kind of the conclusion. So I would certainly support this. Chris Dockington.
If we're ready for a motion, I would propose one that we approve the concept of the recreation, Twin Falls Recreation Center ad hoc committee with advisory committee not to exceed 11 people. From as many divergent backgrounds in the community as possible, pertinent to recreation.
Is there a second for that motion?
I'm trying to count.
Sorry, Wendy, I guess you don't get your recreation center.
So this committee has 12
this
and
has
then
12
two
and
liaisons.
Then two liaisons.
Okay, so I don't see a second for that, so we're going to say that motion died for lack of a second. Suzanne Hawkins.
I would like to make a motion that we approve the request for a Twin Falls Center ad hoc committee and have our Parks and Rec director fill the committee the way she feels best and then bring that list of names back to us, and we can go from there.
Second.
Motion by Suzanne Hawkins, seconded by Greg Lanting. Basically to approve this charter and ask that a list of recommended appointments come back to the council.
So there'd be no upper limit then on the number of members?
It would be on this charter, which is 12 plus two council members.
Oh, it doesn't 12, mention
12 plus a council member and a Parks and Rec liaison.
The motion said as she dealt with, as she chooses.
But within this charter, correct?
If she feels that she needs to make a change, I'm okay with that. That's why I said bring the names back so we can deal with how many at that
time.
Right. Because if she needs to cut it down or make it bigger, I trust her decision on that. It's her committee. She needs the information she needs.
So to clarify for me then, that isn't necessarily approving this charter since this charter lists 12 people.
So the motion was to approve the Recreation Center ad hoc committee.
But not the charter.
Do you need the charter approved too?
That's the other item that's being requested of us this evening is approval of the charter. Okay. And within the charter is the committee membership.
Okay, if the second agrees, then and the charter.
Sure.
Okay, so the motion is to approve the charter
and
as written or with flexibility that the director determine the committee membership?
The latter.
Okay. So the motion is to approve the charter, but the committee membership would still be flexible at the discretion of the director. Is there any discussion? So I will add discussion. I think if this is the draft of the charter that came to us from the Parks and Rec director already and from city staff, that this is what we should just go with instead of leaving it nebulous in the future, or to let her go back and come up with that recommendation and bring the whole thing back again.
I'll move to amend to suggest that the structure be along the specific wording presented to the council so far as its composition and size.
Is there a second to that motion? All right, so that motion dies for lack of a second. Chris Reed.
The reason I think I like the vice mayor's motion is for the committees that I've been on, there's no reason that a banker should have been on the wastewater treatment committee, and I was. And so I would rather you pick the committee and allow people to join as they deem necessary instead of saying, oh, sorry, you don't fit in these categories, and we already have an at-large. So that's why I would rather allow her the freedom to do that.
Nikki Boyd.
The idea of too many people, I understand that that can be a problem, but also on this committee work, not everybody can be at every meeting all the time. And I think if you have this many, you want a solid committee that everybody brings something, but also for you to have the flexibility to pick the people that need to be there, that are consistently there, is really important. And so, some might fall off, or somebody might be added because they bring something to the table that is good information. So that's why I'm for that.
Any other discussion? Okay, so just make sure everyone knows the motion is to approve the charter and to have Wendy bring back a committee membership to the council. Sharon, roll call vote, please.
Suzanne Hawkins?
Yes.
Greg Lanting?
Yes.
Ruth Pierce?
Yes.
Christopher Reed?
Yes.
Chris Talkington?
Yes.
Sean Berriger?
Yes.
Nikki Boyd?
Yes.
Motion passes 7-0.
Thank you.
Thank you, Wendy. So we do have a couple of public hearings that were scheduled to start no sooner than 6 o'clock, and we're about 7 minutes after 6, and we have a few more items on our regular agenda, so if you're here for the public hearings, it will be just a bit. And next on the agenda is a request to adopt an ordinance for a zoning district change and zoning map amendment from R2 to residential business for property located at 838 Filer Avenue. Jonathan Spendlove, Senior Planner.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Really quickly, we've created the ordinance that was asked of us on March 27th. City Council held a public hearing. No public input was given, and there was a motion, and it was seconded, and the motion was approved 6-0. So we prepared the ordinance to change that zoning. To approve it tonight, it would need to be placed on third and final to make it so we could publish it and codify it.
So an ordinance number.
Thank you, Sharon. Do you have an ordinance number?
Ordinance number 2017-11.
Greg Lantic.
Mayor, I move that we place ordinance 2017-11 on third and final by title owner only by suspension of the rules.
Second.
Motion by Greg Lanting, seconded by Ruth Pierce to place ordinance 2017-11 on third and final reading by title only, suspending the rules. Is there any discussion? Sharon, roll call vote, please.
Greg Lanting?
Yes.
Ruth Pierce?
Yes.
Christopher Reed?
Yes.
Chris Talkington?
Yes.
Sean Berger?
Yes.
Nikki Boyd?
Yes.
Suzanne Hawkins?
Yes.
Motion passes 7-0. Sharon, would you read the title, please?
Ordinance number 2017-11, an ordinance of the City Council of the City of Twin Falls, Idaho, rezoning real property below described, providing the zoning classification, therefore, and ordering the necessary amendments to the area of impact and zoning district map and the revised area of impact and comprehensive plan land use map.
Thank you. Chris Dawkins.
Move passage of 2017-11.
Second.
Motion by Chris Dawkins, seconded by Nikki Boyd, to approve ordinance 2017-11. Is there any discussion? Sharon, roll call vote, please.
Ruth Pierce?
Yes.
Christopher Reed?
Yes.
Chris Talkington?
Yes.
Sean Berger?
Yes.
Nikki Boyd?
Yes.
Suzanne Hawkins?
Yes.
Greg Lanting?
Yes.
Motion passes 7-0. Next is a request to adopt an ordinance for annexation of 1.3 plus or minus acres located at 305, 307, and 309 Hankins Road South. And again, Jonathan Spendlove.
So we've got a couple of these that will kind of be autopilot a little bit because it's the same type of process. The council heard this on April 3rd. There was no public input. There was a motion and a second, and all members present voted. It was a 7-0 approval. We have prepared the ordinance again to have it adopted, placing on third and final reading so it can be codified, published. That's all.
I'm going to guess 2017-12.
Yes.
Okay. Suzanne Hawkins?
I move that we suspend the rules and put ordinance 2017-12 on third and final by title only.
I'll second that.
Motion by Suzanne Hawkins, seconded by Ruth Pierce, to suspend the rules and place ordinance 2017-12 on third and final reading by title only. Is there any discussion? Sharon, roll call vote, please.
Christopher Reed?
Yes.
Chris Talkington?
Yes.
Sean Berger?
Yes.
Nikki Boyd?
Yes.
Suzanne Hawkins?
Yes.
Greg Lanting?
Yes.
Ruth Pierce?
Yes.
Motion passes 7-0. Sharon, would you read the title, please?
Ordinance number 2017-12, an ordinance of the City Council of the City of Twin Falls, Idaho, annexing certain real property below described, providing the zoning classification, therefore, and ordering the necessary area of impact and zoning district map amendments.
Thank you. Council wishes. Greg Lanting.
Move approval of ordinance 2017-12.
Second.
Well, that was like everybody all at once.
Sickening.
Motion by Greg Lanting, seconded by Ruth Pierce to approve ordinance 2017-12. Wasn't you? No, it must have been you, Chris. Maybe your voice cracked. Chris Reed. Motion by Greg Lanting, seconded by Christopher Reed to approve ordinance 2017-12. Is there any discussion? Sharon, roll call vote, please.
Chris Talkington?
Yes.
Sean Berger?
Yes.
Nikki Boyd?
Yes.
Suzanne Hawkins?
Yes.
Greg Lanting?
Yes.
Ruth Pierce?
Yes.
Christopher Reed?
Yes.
Motion passes 7-0. And next up, request to adopt an ordinance for a zoning district change and zoning map amendment from R4 to R4 PRO for Lot 22, Block 4 of the Golden Rule subdivision, located north and east of the intersection of Addison Avenue and Jackson Street. Jonathan Spendlove.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. This one, due lack of negligence on my part or the new system, did not have the date of when you guys heard this. It was actually on March 27th. There was a public hearing. There was no public input at that time, and the council approved this request by a vote of 6-0. We've prepared the ordinance. Again, third and final, if it is to be published and codified. That's all.
2017-13. Nikki Boyd.
I move that we suspend the rules and place 2017-13 on third and final reading by title only.
Second.
Motion by Nikki Boyd, seconded by Suzanne Hawkins, to suspend the rules and place Ordinance 2017-13 on third and final reading by title only. Any discussion? Sharon, roll call vote, please.
Okay, just a minute. Just a minute.
That's okay.
We're having a little problem here. Let's see.
Technology.
Okay, Chris Talkington?
Yes.
Sean Berger?
Yes.
Nikki Boyd?
Yes.
Suzanne Hawkins?
Yes.
Greg Lanting?
Yes.
Ruth Pierce?
Yes.
Christopher Reed?
Yes.
Motion passes 7-0. Sharon, could you read the title, please? Or would you like me to read the title while you're doing that? Because I'm happy to.
Sorry about this.
That's quite all right.
Ordinance number 2017-13. An ordinance of the City Council of the City of Twin Falls, Idaho, rezoning real property below described, providing the zoning classification, therefore, and ordering the necessary amendments to the area of impact and zoning district map and the revised area of impact and comprehensive plan land use map.
Thank you. Council wishes. Suzanne Hawkins.
I move approval of ordinance number 2017-13.
Second.
Motion by Suzanne Hawkins, seconded by Ruth Pierce, to approve Ordinance 2017-13. Is there any discussion? Sharon, roll call vote, please.
Okay. Hold on just a minute.
Which item are you on?
We are on item
F.
F, yes. 7F.
Handling the two motions
per item, maybe. Sean, who seconded that?
I did.
Ruth Pierce.
Ruth Pierce.
A motion by Suzanne Hawkins, seconded by Ruth Pierce.
I did.
Okay. Sean Berger?
Yes.
Nikki Boyd?
Yes.
Suzanne Hawkins?
Yes.
Greg Lanting?
Yes.
Ruth Pierce?
Yes.
Christopher Reed?
Yes.
Chris Talkington?
Yes.
Motion passes 7-0. Okay. Next is a presentation, so no voting, Sharon. You'll be in good shape. Take a little breather there. Presentation on the finances of the City of Twin Falls for the first 6 months of the fiscal year 2016-2017. The presentation will be an overview of the tax-supported funds and the three major enterprise funds, water, wastewater, and sanitation. We have our CFO, Lori Race. Welcome, Lori.
Good evening. So tonight we're going to be reviewing the city's finances for the first half of fiscal year 2017. 6 months is our 50% benchmark that we'll be using, and that's how we'll gauge how we're doing. And we'll start with the tax-supported funds. I'll hit the four major revenue sources. We'll talk about the four expenditure categories, and we'll do the same in our enterprise funds, water, wastewater, and sanitation. So this is just a reminder. We have 9 tax-supported funds receiving the majority of their revenues from taxes: general, street, streetlight, library, airport, capital improvement fund, pool, insurance, and fireworks. The largest contributing revenue sources in the tax-supported funds are property taxes at 52% of the budget, franchise fees at 5, state shared revenues at 10, highway monies at 8, transfers at 8%. The total of these revenues is almost $31 million, and together they make up 85% of our total revenue picture in the tax-supported funds. Property taxes contribute the largest amount of resources. And the $19.3 million we expect to receive this year is over half of that tax-supported fund budget. This graph shows the total amount of property taxes budgeted and then received for the first 6 months of each fiscal year for the past 4 years. And as you can see, fiscal year 2017 is consistent with past years and absolutely what we would expect. The franchise fees are coming in just a tick above where they were last year at 61% of budget. And we receive these revenues from natural gas, power, cable companies, and they're the rent that those utilities pay to use the city's right-of-ways. So just to share with you that we received our payment for gas, and it came in about 2% above budget. And so that means an additional $7,700. Power is estimated to come in about 5% over budget, and that'll be about $80,000 more than I budgeted. But, you know, based on the winter that we had, that's really not that unexpected. And cable is projected to come in about 4% under budget. As I've shared with you in the past, this revenue source continues to decline. I budgeted an 8% decrease from last year, and I'm projecting about $8,000 less than what I budgeted. Our state shared revenues are received quarterly, and they are spot on with the prior three-year average of 52% of budget. So last quarter, I shared that the State of Idaho Division of Financial Management reported that the receipts and collections were up 7% over the prior year. So that told me that, you know, maybe my revenue projection is a little low. However, in their most recent report, and it's dated April 2017, that increase has softened. They're reporting that March was a third consecutive month with sales tax receipts short of the target. They believe that may be partially due to severe weather, which curtailed shopping, travel, and construction activity. But because the way it was the first 3 months and the way it was projected the next three, this revenue projection seems to be right in line with budget and past years. The highway user revenue is up from the prior three-year average. We're sitting about 50%, 57% of budget, and the prior three-year average was 55. This budget has increased a little over 2%, and the prior year we jumped at 35% because of the legislative action to increase fuels tax and vehicle registration fees, and these funds stay in the street fund. So that's a look at the major revenues in the tax-supported funds. We've received 62% of budgeted revenues through March, and that's above where we typically are, but that has to do with the sweep from the general fund to the capital improvement fund. So we're going to move on to expenditures, and this slide illustrates the percentage of budget allocated to each category. Personnel takes up 60% of the budget, M&O 19, capital improvements 16, and fund transfers of 5. In reviewing the expenditure categories in these 9 tax-supported funds, we start with personnel, and actual costs include 13 out of 26 payrolls, so this should be close to 50% spent. Prior three-year average was about 46%, and in light of our mid-year adjustments that occurred in early February, this category is up from those past years at 48%. M&O is below the 50% benchmark. Capital costs are higher than budgeted, but that's due to the progress on the City Hall and the Police Department projects. Through April 17th, we've spent $4.5 million on this project, and that will be included in a year-end budget amendment. Our transfers are high, but that again is due to the annual sweep. And overall, tax-supported funds are at 57%, halfway through the fiscal year. This includes the capital expenditures that will be in the year-end budget amendment and the transfer. So I have just one more item I'd like to share before we move to the enterprise funds. And this handout was included in your agenda packet, and I just want to point out a few things. The first one is the same thing I pointed out 3 months ago, and that's our court revenues. They're down from where they have been in past years. As I shared with you before, it's not really very easy to define why. There's just way too many variables of whether or not there are acquittals, dismissals by the court, dismissals by the prosecutor, whether they've been paid, whether they haven't been paid. But recently I was contacted by the city of Boise and one of their internal auditors, and they are really experiencing a downturn in this revenue source, and they can't figure out why. The next piece is that investment income. I was a little off this year. We allocate that investment income based on cash balances in our various funds. And I anticipated a decrease in our investments due to the cash going out for the City Hall project and the police department project and finishing up our wastewater treatment plant. Apparently, I was a little too conservative on this. I'm estimating we'll receive probably about $30,000 more in investment income in the tax-supported funds this year. I'm sorry. I guess that's not a bad problem to
say,
have.
If you're going to pick a place to be conservative, that's not a bad problem.
The other thing, wire transfers at anything other than 50%, we've talked about that, it's the sweep. And caps are high because of our projects, City Hall and Police Department. So overall, our tax-supported fund revenues are at 62% for this time of year. Personnel and M&O expenditures are below our 50% benchmark, and we've discussed caps and transfers. Does anybody have any questions about tax-supported stuff before we move into the enterprise funds?
Chris Talkington.
Looking back at the expense side under personnel, it surprises me we're this close to budget. I mean, if you take the 6 months times two, become pretty close to that $21 million. But we've been understaffed in the police department for most of this year, I think just up until recently. Do you see a trend now with the full employment there, the police being our largest segment of our personnel costs, that we're going to be blowing over that personnel?
I don't think we are, Chris.
Well, how do you explain spending so much on the first 50 or the first 6 months of maybe I missed something of what you're saying?
So in the personnel line item, we are 13 out of 26 payrolls, so we should be exactly half. I would expect us to be very close to that because we do have full employment in the police department now. However, we're not, and it's probably salary savings from the first few months. So even with those mid-year adjustments, we're not hitting that 50% benchmark. We're a tick below at 48.
Okay. So you had the answer. I figured
I think we're fine there.
We'll check back in 6 months.
All right. Or maybe nine.
Yeah.
I don't see any more questions, Laura.
All right.
Roll on through.
So this graph shows the actual user fee revenues received for the first half of each fiscal year from 2014 through 2017 in our water fund. And in looking back at the past 12 years of revenue history, we're typically at about 38% of the total revenue we'll receive for the year. We currently stand at 39.7% of our budget. Our personnel costs in the water fund are below the 50% benchmark, and M&O expenditures are well below budget. But summer's coming, and pumping costs will boost the M&O expenditures. Capital projects are showing that we're 133% spent, but that's due to the carryover of the Wills Booster Station project. If you remove about $1.5 million of expenditures that are carryover, that is really much more in line at about 14%. We made an interest payment in the debt category, and the remaining interest and principal payment will be made in late August. Transfers are at 50%, and overall, We're showing 44% spent halfway through the fiscal year before adjusting for the Wills Booster Station project. If you reduce the total expenditures by that project, it's 29% of budget. In the wastewater fund, we start with revenues and a look at the total residential, industrial, and municipal use fee budgets, along with actual amounts received to date. This information is provided for fiscal year 2015 through current, and you can see we're just a little over 50% for our current fiscal year. And on our expenditure side, personnel costs and M&O are well below our 50% benchmark. CAP is showing it's over budget, but the majority of these expenditures are the finishing up of the wastewater treatment plant, and that will be included in budget amendment. An interest payment was made in February, and just like in the water fund, we'll make the rest of those payments in late August. Transfers are on track. And all in all, this fund is showing 77% spent to date. But if you take out $3 million that has been paid towards the wastewater treatment plant, this fund is closer to 45% spent halfway through the year. And finally, we get to sanitation. When looking at the revenues, excluding just a small portion of interest income, you can see the amount received year to date is almost 50% for all the years, and this fund is right where it needs to be. Expenditures in sanitation really don't need very much explanation. M&O looks like we're under the benchmark, but PSI and the landfill bill after the fact. So this is only 5 months of expenditures. After adjusting for the March payments, this category is about 48% spent. There's no capital and there's no debt. Transfers are where they need to be. And overall, after adjusting the M&O expenditures to include 6 payments instead of 5, this budget goes from looking like it's only 41% spent to about 48.4% halfway through the year. My last slide. So before we finish up, I wanted to provide this slide on recycling. It shows the number of tons diverted from the landfill by year from 2011 through March of 2017. And we get this information from PSI monthly, and I started trying to graph it like that, but it was really very difficult for me to draw any solid conclusions from. So I decided to annualize it. And what I was hoping to see was a slight trend upwards. But what I saw, and this just overlays the percentage change. So there was a 2.3% increase from 11 to 12, and 2012 was our best year. Then we had a 5.3% decrease, followed by a 1.9% increase. Then the last 2 years have been down 1.3% and 1% respectively. So I contacted PSI and I asked Jeff Brewster to share with me, do you have any insights? What can you help me understand? They believe that the decline in 2013 was attributed to the removal of Recycle Bank. Also a decline in newsprint, with more residents reading online news and eliminating much of the delivery of the daily newspapers. He also said newspapers began reducing the size and the weight of the newsprint going to customers. And then he identified in 15 and 16, they believe those declines are exclusively due to reducing the amount of trash from recycling containers. So we still have a significant number of customers not understanding the program or choosing to ignore the requirements. So Jeff shared with me that he spoke with Western Recycling in Boise, and we, the city of Twin Falls, have the most contaminated material going to their facility. Jeff believes we may have another year with slight declines in total volume. So what happens is when you put the trash in the recycle bin, the whole thing gets thrown out, so it's not diverted, it goes to the landfill. PSI sent a flyer that they'll be placing on their website soon and on customers' containers with trash in the recycle bins to further educate them. And I've asked Josh Palmer to put that on our website as well. One other little thing to share. When I was looking at their information, you know there's a cost to recycling, right? We don't get recycling revenue. For January of 17, the cost was $35 a ton. February, it was $30 a ton. And for March, it was $20 a ton. So the good news is commodity prices are rising. And that... is a look at revenues and expenditures for our three major enterprise funds. Revenues are coming in as expected. Expenditures are at or below the 50% benchmark with explanations for our deviations. Sanitation is on track with revenues and expenditures. And that's all I have for you tonight, and I'd be happy to answer questions.
Any questions? Chris talked.
Would you let us know when you find out more about those court revenues that seem to be in a down mode, you say in several or all jurisdictions around the state?
Okay. I'm sorry, Chris. Ask me that one more time.
Court revenues, I think, were down.
Yes.
But you say you contacted Boise? Or
Boise contacted me and asked, gosh, what are you seeing in this? And I explained to him that I'd contacted Christina Glasscock to ask her what she could share with me. And our revenues are down, but theirs were down significantly, like between 30 and 40%. Hmm. So, yeah, if I find out anything more, I'll be sure and share.
Thank you, Lori. Travis, did you have something to add? Nope. Well, thank you for the presentation. Always a nice check-in. Always good to know that we're right where we thought we were going
to
be.
Right where we need to be.
Okay, next is advisory board reports and announcements. Anything from the council? Travis, do you have anything? Okay, then we will move into the public hearings. Everybody good to keep going?
Yes.
Okay. So the first public hearing is a request for the vacation of 15-foot by 78.52-foot, 1,178-square-foot utility and drainage easement between lots 3 and 4 of the J.E. White subdivision, number 2, on property located at 985 Beverly Circle in care of Blue Lakes Place, LLC, Jim Paxton.
Dave
Tebow will be presenting on behalf of the applicant. There are not enough lines on the new agenda for all these things to be written on there. So
I saw the new agenda as well, and I went down and actually printed the previous week's agenda, thinking that there certainly was an error.
My name is
Dave Tebow with EHM Engineers at 621 North College, Mr. Mayor and members of the council. I'm representing Mr. Jim Paxton and Blue Lakes Place, LLC, who is the owner of the subject property that we're talking about here this evening. We've requested a vacation of an easement that was platted in, I believe, the late 60s as part of the J.E. White subdivision plat. Following the platting of this property, ultimately Ash Street, as highlighted in yellow here, and I think it's Beverly Circle, those two streets were vacated and are no longer in existence. However, there was a little strip right here of easement, 15-foot wide by about 78 feet long, coming out of the cul-de-sac and extending northerly, that was not vacated. As we evaluate usage and land usage and development of this property, we would like to go through the process and eliminate that easement. To our knowledge, there are no existing utilities located within or occupying that easement, and we have sent letters out to that effect requesting input from any stakeholders of that easement and have not received any comments to the contrary. So we had a hearing before the Planning and Zoning Commission. They recommended approval, and that we come seek your approval this evening. So we're here to ask that this be vacated by the City Council and the City. With that, I'd stand for any questions.
Thank you, Dave. Any questions for Dave? Seeing none, I'll turn it over to the staff for a staff report. Jonathan.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. The brief history is that this was part of the J.E. White subdivision. 1963 is when it was recorded. Then the address first appeared about 1969, and Mitch has an aerial up here. Kind of show the area. Florence comes in here. Blue Lakes is just a little bit over here to the left. This is the Blue Lakes Inn. This is Beverly Circle, or what was Beverly Circle. The easement's somewhere in this area. The owner, Mr. Paxson, owns quite a few lots in here, and he'd like to build something that would go in this area. You can't build on an easement. We don't permit that within our code, so he needs to vacate it in order to build across that area. That's pretty much in a nutshell. On March 28th, the Planning and Zoning Commission forwarded a positive recommendation to the council by unanimous vote. And in conclusion, should the City Council grant this request as presented, staff recommends approval be subject to the following condition. It's subject to the site plan amendments as required by building, engineering, fire, and zoning officials to ensure compliance with applicable city requirements and standards. We don't foresee any, but just in case. That is all.
Thank you, Jonathan. So we'll open it up for the public hearing. Is there anyone here wishing to speak on this item? Seeing no one, we will close the public input portion of the public hearing. And Dave, did you have anything else to add?
We're aware of staff recommendations. Have no problem with that.
Okay. Thank you. Any questions or discussion from the council? Greg Lant.
Mayor, I move that we grant the request of vacation of 15 by 78.52 feet, 1,178 square feet, utility and drainage easements between lots 3 and 4 of the J.E. White subdivision number 2 on property located at 985 Beverly Circle, and include the staff recommendations.
With second that. Motion.
Nikki, Boyd?
Second.
Okay. Go ahead.
A motion by Greg Lanning, seconded by Nikki Boyd, to approve the request as presented and with the staff recommendations. Is there any discussion? Sharon, roll call vote, please.
Sean Berger?
Yes.
Nikki Boyd?
Yes.
Suzanne Hawkins?
Yes.
Greg Lantine?
Yes.
Ruth Pierce?
Yes.
Christopher Reed?
Yes.
Chris Talkington?
Yes.
Motion passes 7-0. Thanks, Dave. And next, we have a request to adopt a resolution setting city pool and recreation department fees. We have Wendy Davis, our Parks and Recreation Director. Welcome back, Wendy.
Good evening again. So this evening, I printed out a lot of stuff, but I didn't get this one. So see if I can see it. Basically, this evening, I'm coming before you to ask for... Thank you. Stacy saved my bacon, as usual. So as we are maneuvering through the acquisition of the city pool and setting new fees and prices, for the most part, we're determining that everything we're doing is new. So even though the admission prices exist and we're not changing them because we're moving from a Y-operated facility to a city-operated facility, we've included those as well. So we've made some changes and recommendations to swimming lists and fees and pool pass prices, but admissions are staying the same. And as we are navigating that process, realized that we might have been in failure to comply by not bringing all the recreation fees that are self-supporting in front of you. So that's why those are on the list as well. Those haven't been brought before you in the past because they were determined to be self-supporting and not necessarily up for public hearings. So in the discussion about the pool fees, we realized we needed to bring those as well. So you've got a list of a lot of fees, and I have Stacy and John with me this evening to help answer questions if you have specific questions about any of those fees. Do you want to do that? Okay. Do you want to go through that? So I'll let John talk about where the pool fees, how we arrived at those fees.
Chris Togginen has a question. Did you want to ask your question? Narrow wait till after.
Well, it's about the fees, and you may cover this, but I understand why we're doing this since we're taking over the pool again. But I'm particularly interested in the fees for the 3 and under and the 4 and 17, that 250 and 350. What does that represent percentage-wise over what had been charged last year for non-Y members?
It hasn't changed.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes.
That's good.
Nothing in the daily adult, child, 4 to 17, 3 and under changed. That stayed the same.
Thank you.
You're welcome. So to arrive at for our process of coming up with these recommendations, we wanted a process, a fee structure, and I'm talking more about the passes right now, that was simple and easy to understand. You look at a lot of aquatic facilities or Ys or recreation centers, and you see a lot of complex pricing, and I've encountered that in the past, and it's not a good way to run a facility, in my opinion. And with the type of one focus, one activity facility we have, an aquatic facility, simpler seemed like the better option to me. So for our passes, we came up with a resident, non-resident fee structure. The reason for that being is the residents contribute directly to the operation of the city pool with their taxes, so we thought it was appropriate to have a resident and non-resident fee structure for those. The annuals compared to the monthlies are a little bit different than it was done before. What we came up with for our individual pass holders, when you compare the old Y prices, it was, say, $212 for an annual individual for the year. And they were paying in $25.43 a month for the person that had a monthly pass. Well, we came up and found out that that was 3.6 months for free. And that's a lot of time to give away for free. And that's where this structure comes in. That's where these annuals come in as higher, as well as a partial portion being an increase as well. So we went with a times 10 strategy. So, for example, you take the monthly family pass for the resident, $38. You just take that times 10, and you get $380. That also roots back to that being simple and easy to understand, easy to justify. So that's where we came up with how we came up with our monthlies to annuals to come up with an easy, clean system. So I'll go through the prices one by one now, and if any questions come up, I'd be happy to answer those. So for our individual annual pass for a resident, we're looking at $270, and for a non-resident, $320. For the monthly one, same idea, $27 and $32. It goes with the same for the family. So for the family, we're looking at $38 and $43, resident, non-resident, and then $380 and $430. Oh, before I continue, all these fees do include the taxes included in them as well. We also included a summer pass on here. We wanted to be cautious. We want to offer this, especially we're coming up very close to summer, so it made sense to add this on here. And by doing that, we basically just took 3 months, you know, bubble down to bubble up, so a little more than 3 months. So June, July, August, into September. It made sense. It works. It's a good timeline. It's an easy to define timeline. And that's where we came up with our 110 and 130 for the family, and 80 and 95. So before I get into the program pricing, is there any questions I can answer on the passes? Okay.
Nope.
Thank you. So for our swim lessons, we're proposing that for the summer months, it's a 35 and 50 split, pass holder, non-pass holder. I should have touched on this a minute ago. So when you buy your pass, it's not after you've bought your pass, the programs are structured so it's pass holder, non-pass holder, not resident, non-resident, because then at that point, the resident's putting in their portion as well. So it made sense to convert to a pass, non-pass holder type of format for pricing. So I wanted to make sure I went over that before I went into too much into the program pricing. So the summer pricing is 35 and 50. Our goal is to get as many kids in swim lessons as we can. So we have higher ratios, you know, 1-6, 1-8, depending on the level. You know, 1-6 for the smaller ones, 1-8 for the ones that are swimming, learning the other strokes. It makes sense to have a higher ratio because we want to get as many kids in these programs as we can because summer is our high-risk time throughout the area, and with flooding, who knows? Hopefully, we can train. If it makes one difference,
It's worth it. Then we get into the winter ones. Reason for the change there, 45 and 65, is we would go with a smaller ratio, a 1-to-4. It is a little difficult to get to a 1-to-6 or 1-to-8 in the non-summer months. So we have a smaller ratio, more one-on-one. Maybe somebody's looking for more of that one-on-one attention. So it made sense to try to adopt maybe a smaller ratio in the non-summer months. And it makes it easier for you to for your costs as well. Our summer hurricanes, we priced those, water babies. My past theory is just a little different. With water babies, it's a 4-class, half-hour per class time. So depending on the format we go with, it could be 2 weeks twice a week or 4 weeks once a week with 15 and 25. So when we get into our summer hurricanes, 85 and 115, that program has grown and grown and grown. Travis knows what I'm talking about. Chris knows what I'm talking about. It's a big program, and it's gotten popular, especially in the non-summer months. So I wanted to give you an idea of what you get with that 85 and 115, because that is the most expensive program on this list. You get 8 weeks in the summer, 8 weeks, 4 days a week, an hour and a half at a time with 4-time trial meets. So you're getting a lot for that. And it's most during the highest peaks of the summer. You know, we shoot for 150, 200 kids to take part in this program. There's a lot of resources that go into it, hence that is why we have the higher proposal for price. Now, when it comes to the winter hurricane program, 45 and 65, not as much. Twice a week, still 8 weeks long, an hour long. And the Saturday meets every other Saturday. So it makes sense for that to go down, because we're not going to get people there with the idea of 4 times a week. Might get some. There'd probably be some diehards that would, I'm not going to lie. But feasibility, this is more realistic. Thank you. And then our last category is our junior lifeguard camp. And I don't see the non-pass holder on that one. Is it? Okay. 25 and 35, this is a program we primarily do in the summer. Back with the why we tried doing this in the other times of the year, and it doesn't really work. Spring break it does. But it's more of a summer program because it's bringing that attention to being outside in the aquatic environment. And it's a fun, popular program. So, and we go over saves, basic CPR, first aid with the kids, and really teaches them a sense of responsibility. So we really like that program. So we pros 25 and 35 for that. With our private swim lesson program, it's 70 and 90. And what that includes is 4 half-hour one-on-one lessons. With the instructor, if they have an instructor they can choose, they can choose that instructor. So you're paying for that attention and time, because it's very, you know, what we have doesn't work, this will work for you, because when we're open, we can teach these lessons. Birthday parties. So we're proposing 75 and 90. With the birthday parties, what that includes is admission for 10 non-member kids. We're not going to tally the kids that are members of the pool. That just wouldn't be okay for that. 2 picnic tables for 2 hours, and they can swim the whole time. Say if it's not Saturday afternoon, they have the picnic tables from 1 to 3. They can keep swimming after that, but they get scheduled time with those picnic tables. And I didn't realize, I mean, I knew our birthday parties were pretty busy, but you don't realize how busy they are until they're gone. And we've noticed that in April since we haven't been selling them. And it'll be nice to get that program back up again. And then to finish off with our rod aerobics, and I wanted to go into a little more detail on this because the number says it, but it doesn't say it. What the 0 means for the pass holder is that it's included in their pass. So we're planning on offering our own water fitness program. So programs we offer that are water fitness programs, they're going to be able to just, if they have their pass, go in and go do. That's what we want to do. Now, maybe we decide we want to do some water aerobics, partner up with another organization in town. That would be a different situation. But we're going to offer classes as a part of that membership or pass. And then say somebody that wants to come in and do a class one time, you know, I'm in from Boise, you know, out of town, it'd be $8. And the rent for that is $450 for the day pass and $350 that goes towards the water aerobic program to help fund that. So that is a rundown of our aquatic pricing for programs and passes. Is there any questions I can answer?
Bet you have those memorized, don't you?
It hasn't taken long.
I don't see any questions.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Very thorough.
Yeah, that was a good presentation. Are we covering the recreation stuff too or no? No. Okay. Any more presentation then? So with that, I will open it up for the opportunity for public input. If there's anyone here wishing to speak on this item, now's your chance to come forward. Come on forward and please state your name and address for the record. And
my name is John Twiss, 2030 Bitterroot Drive. So congratulations. I'm super excited that you guys are running the city pool. I'm really excited that you're looking at doing a community rec center. Twin Falls is getting cooler and cooler. So it's super exciting time to be a resident of Twin Falls. And I want the city to be very successful running the city pool. I used to run it in 2002, 2004 for the YMCA. One thing on the pricing, and I know pricing is elusive, right? You've got supply and demand, you have price elasticity, you have all sorts of factors that go into pricing, and I know it can be quite a challenge. So, but one thing I'd like everyone to consider on pricing and just kind of look at it is during, we've got two seasons. In the summertime, that pool is packed. It's busy all the time, which is awesome. That's what we want. During the other months, it's busy, but it's not at capacity. I'm worried, and I'm taking these out the newspaper prices, so if I'm wrong, that was my source. But it looks like the individual annual pass would go up 27%, and the family annual pass would go up 31%. And my concern is when we took over in 2002, we dropped the membership price dramatically because we wanted the pool to be full during the year. So, I mean, you can look at it and say, well, I only have 100 people coming in the fall, so I'll just charge them twice as much and my revenue will go up twice as much. It won't go up twice as much. You'll lose some of those people. But if you drop your price in half and your capacity is huge, we found immediately we sold, I don't know how many fold more memberships. And memberships are a great thing. We're all excited about them at first, and then, you know, things come up and life happens. And so the potential to sell a lot of memberships during the colder months is large, and I'm just concerned that if we raise these rates this dramatically, if anything, I would keep them the same or go down. I think you'll make a lot more money. Now, the summer is different, and that's kind of interesting, the pricing. You might even look at going up a bit in the summertime. I hate to say that people will be mad at me tomorrow, but the summer, you are maxed out. You have lots and lots of people. And so if the experience is lousy in the summer because you're trying to cram too many people in there, you have to think about that as well. The other big win, and I think is, and it's great that you're looking at a new rec center, but something to consider is putting super fun things to be there in the pool, especially during those colder months. And you can put inflatables in. I know John's had those in there before with the Y, and they've kind of gone away. But those can increase, they'll increase your membership sales for one, for sure, and then they increase your daily attendance as well. And those things, some of them are, they'll only last a few years, and you can, but if you run the return on investment in there, I think they're totally worth it. And then a slide there, you have a monopoly in town in terms of nice water space. I mean, the Y has their four-lane pool, and it's good for a few things, but you could do very well putting in some nice kiddie pool features, some splash stuff. It doesn't take a lot of money to heat that water or to chemical it and that kind of stuff. Lifeguarding cost. I mean, payroll's huge. Your overhead is what it is, right? We're paying overhead on full-time people. We're paying chemicals. We're paying, that place might as well be as full as possible. And so I think you can do that by making it more fun. Investing in it, you can take some of those assets if you do build a new community rec center, and you can probably move over there if they're not worn out by then. But anyway, I'd just be a little bit careful about the annual passes. I'd relook at that possibly. I think you're gonna hurt yourself come in the fall. You might be fine for the summertime because that's the busy time.
Thank you, John. Is there anyone else from the public who wishes to speak on this issue? If not, I will close the public input portion of the public hearing. Chris Talkington.
Yeah, I'm not sure I understand, John. You might have to come back up, or maybe I'm the only one that had a problem. You're saying that one of those was at the winter swim pass was going up how much percent?
No, I'm talking about the individual annual pass, the resident pass. That's going to go up 27% if if this newspaper is correct on the prices there. I think it was $220.
Gotcha.
Yeah, it was.
Thank you.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
Thank you, John. All right, so the public input portion is closed. Turn it over to council for direction. Sharon, do we have a resolution number?
Resolution number 2017-6.
Chris Dockington.
2017-6, I would move passage of that with the comment that I don't think the solution to our taking over the pool is to see how much money we can give, but to provide as much use for as many people in the city, maybe the surrounding area for the additional amount we pay. But just like golf, it's a subsidized form of recreation. We may end up tweaking this after the first year if we find that usage goes up and down. But I think this is a pretty good start we made on trying to make sense of that. So that's why I'm moving for passage of the resolution.
Second.
A motion by Chris Hockington, second by Suzanne Hopkins to approve resolution 2017-6. Greg Lanting.
I will be voting in favor of the resolution, but I do like some of John's ideas and where I think that maybe for if we look at things, give us just some time. We probably took this back over, so we're certainly finding our way, so to speak. We do have people who are already there to help us, but to his point, in the winter, maybe we could look at the monthly rate is higher in the summer and lower in the winter, so that people could utilize it that way if they choose not to get a season pass. Some people don't like to go there when all the kids are there in the summer, but they certainly like to be there in the winter time and things. And I'm also very impressed with the 1-6 and 1-8. I didn't have children, so my last thought process was taking swimming lessons at the Natsu Pa out at Hollister, because I lived out there, and I'm pretty sure we had about 20 first graders in my swimming class, and none of us drowned, but it's probably a surprise that we didn't. So I like those numbers on the ratio of instructor to children.
Thank you, Greg. Any other comments from the council? Seeing none, Sharon, roll call vote, please.
Nikki Boyd?
Yes.
Suzanne Hawkins?
Yes.
Greg Lanting?
Yes.
Ruth Pierce?
Yes.
Christopher Reed?
Yes.
Chris Hockington?
Yes.
Sean Berriger.
Yes. Motion passes 7-0. Next, another opportunity for general public input. If there's anyone here from the public who wishes to address the council on an issue come on down. Any other announcements from the council or the staff? All right. And the meeting is adjourned.
That's a big step.